Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. My name is Dr. Muhammad Ali, and I'm here with you with an experimental series. So we are going to start the chapter 2. This chapter is about the solutions, pH, buffers, and the dilution series. There are a total of 22 experiments in this section, but we will be studying almost 14 experiments from this section. We will be talking about these experiments from the Ali et al. Experimental Biochemistry and Biotechnology Series 1, and it will be its second edition. So what are the contents of this chapter? So we will be talking about the molar solution, normal solution, and we will also be talking about the molarity of acids when only the density and the percentage purity is given. We will also see the percentage solutions, and we will see how the interconversion between the percentage solution and the molar solution is performed. We will also see the parts per million solution and parts per billion solutions. We will see how to make calculations to make a phosphate buffer of pH 7.2. We will be making today the serial dilutions and the parallel dilutions of 1 molar copper sulfate solution, and we will see how the final concentration is there in each case of parallel and the serial dilutions. We will compare and calculate the pH of a solution, and we will compare those values. We will see how to make a multi-component buffer in this section. So this is the manual that will be followed to study to teach all these experiments. So the first experiment is experiment 2.1. This is about how we will prepare the 50 ml of 0.2 molar glucose solution. First of all, the definition of molarity is that it is the number of moles of a solute that is dissolved per decimeter cube of a solution. We need what kind of material in this experiment: weighing balance, weighing paper, spatula, glucose, beaker, distilled water, glass rod, volumetric glass, and the permanent marker for the labeling of the final solution. We already know the molecular weight and the molecular formula of the glucose. The molecular weight of the glucose is 180 gram per mole. First of all, we will distinguish what is given and what is required. So given things are that 50 ml of solution is required to make that is equal to the 0.05 liters. And the molarity that is required is 0.2 molar, and the molecular weight of the glucose is also given. What we need to know the mass of the glucose that is required to make 50 ml of the glucose solution with a final molarity of 0.2 molar. We already know that number of moles are equal to the mass of the glucose or that substance divided by the molecular weight of that substance. And we know that molarity is the number of moles per unit volume. If we read in this equation, mass becomes equal to the moles multiplied by molecular weight. And if we rearrange this equation, the moles becomes equal to the molarity multiplied by the volume. Equation 1 and 2 shows that amount of glucose required is equal to the molarity multiplied by molecular weight multiplied by volume. And if you put these values here, 0.2 mole per liter final concentration and 180 gram per mole the molecular weight and 0.05 liter the final volume, the mass of the glucose comes out to be 1.8 gram. So 1.8 gram. So here we can see that the 1.8 gram glucose is first added in the beaker, then almost 40 ml of the water is added. And we dissolve this one, then this solution is added to a volumetric flask of 50 ml, and we make the volume by adding the distilled water up to 50 ml. This becomes the 0.2 molar of 50 ml solution of glucose. So these are the steps that we will follow to make this solution. First of all, we will weigh 1.8 gram of glucose by using a weighing balance. Then we will take a beaker of 100 ml volume and we will pour the glucose in it. Two steps have been performed. Third, and we will add 40 ml of the distilled water and dissolve by using a glass rod. And after that, we will add solution to a volumetric flask or a measuring cylinder, and we will make the volume to 50 ml. So this is going to make the 0.2 molar of 50 ml solution of glucose. We will label the solution with its name, molarity, and date of preparation. This is very important in making any kind of solution. We will store the solution in the appropriate shelf. What the significance of glucose and its solution is that glucose is one of the major components of cell culture media in biotechnology, biochemistry, and the life science laboratory. And its concentration in the cell culture media is 1000 mg per liter. And this media is routinely used in molecular cell biology labs. And human blood has a concentration of almost 100 mg per deciliter of glucose. And it is the most important sugar in the human metabolism. We now move for the calculation of molarity of a concentrated sulfuric acid whose purity and the density has been given. This is one of the level that I brought to teach you. This level is for the sulfuric acid, and we can see that this level is showing only its density and its percentage purity. The density is 1 liter is equal to the 1.84 kg. It becomes equal to 1.84 gram per mL, and the percentage purity is 95%. We take the example of another label that is for nitric acid. It has been written with SA. SA means the percentage purity. The percentage purity of nitric acid is 64 to 66%, and its density is equal to the 1 liter is nearly equal to 1.4 kg. It means 1.4 gram of nitric acid is contained in 1 ml of this concentrated nitric acid. By using these two information, the percentage purity and the density, how can we calculate the molarity of an acid? For example, this is the problem that calculate the molarity of a concentrated sulfuric acid of 95% purity. What material we need? We need sulfuric acid. Definitely, packing is labeled with density, purity, and the molecular weight. We need a cylinder, beaker, distilled water, and the glass rod. What is given? The given things are 95% purity, that is labeled on the label of the sulfuric acid, density 1.84 gram per ml, and the molecular weight of 98 gram per mole. What is required? We need to know its molarity. What kind of calculations we need? We need to know the first of all the molecular weight 98. Weight of 1 ml of sulfuric acid is equal to 1.84 gram. And weight of 1000 ml of sulfuric acid is equal to 1.84 gram per ml multiplied by 1000 ml. And weight of 1000 ml of 95% pure sulfuric acid, we have to multiply it by 95 divided by 100. We have to multiply this value by 95 divided by 100. And we already know the formula of molarity. By using equation 1 and 2, we are going to find the formula for the calculation of molarity of an acid, and this becomes equal to 17.8 mole per liter. So same experiment, packing of concentrated acid strength is written with percentage purity, density, and molecular weight, but the molarity is not written. That's why it's very important to calculate the molarity from these two parameters. Acetic acid is found in 99.5% purity, and its normality and molarity is 17.4. Hydrochloric acid 11.65, hydrofluoric acid 22.6 molar, and the nitric acid 15.8 molar, and sulfuric acid is found in concentrated form as 18.4 molar. So next experiment is prepare 100 ml of 0.1 normal. Prepare 100 ml of 0.1 normal sulfuric acid solution. Normality is the number of grams equivalent of a solute dissolved per liter of a solution. The symbol for this unit is N. We need these materials to prepare 0.1 normal solution. What are givens? We know already 0.1 liter of solution is required to make, and the normality is 0.1 gram per liter, and the percentage purity is 95%, and the molecular weight is 98 for sulfuric acid, and density is 1.84. We need to know the normality first of all for the concentrated sulfuric acid, and then we have to find the volume that is required to dilute it to make 0.1 liter with a final strength of 0.1 normal. So molecular weight we calculate here 98 gram, and the molarity will be calculated by using this formula. If we divide the molarity by 2, then it becomes a normality and it comes up to be 8.9 normal for the concentrated sulfuric acid. Then we use the N1V1 and N2V2 formula to calculate the initial volume of the sulfuric acid of 8.9 normal that is required to make 0.1 normal of 100 ml sulfuric acid solution. And we calculate the V1, the volume of concentrated sulfuric acid 1.12 ml. So what's the procedure? 70 ml of distilled water in 100 ml volumetric flask, then take 1.12 ml of sulfuric acid by suction pipette and slowly pour into the flask, and then mix it by shaking, and then make the volume up to 100 ml and mix again, and then this will be the 0.1 normal sulfuric acid solution. Label the solution with its name, molarity, and the date of preparation, and then the solution is stored in a proper shelf. These are the steps that are performed to make the solution of sulfuric acid. So the sulfuric acid is used to make the ammonium sulfate, which is important fertilizer for the sulfur deficient soils. So next experiment is, how will you make the 500 ml of 0.601 molar solution of nitric acid? We already know the definition of molarity is the number of moles dissolved per liter of the solution. Its symbol is the M. We need these materials, and this is the molecular weight of the nitric acid. So what is given? The volume is 0.5 ml that is required to make, and the molarity is 0.601 molar, and the molecular weight is 63 gram per mole, and the mass required we need to know. And mass required is equal to the molecular weight multiplied by molarity multiplied by volume, and we need 18.93 gram of the nitric acid to make this solution of our desired strength. And the volume can be calculated by the purity multiplied by mass divided by density, and we put the value of this mass here in this formula, and the volume comes up to be 8.95 ml that is containing 18.93 gram of nitric acid. So we take 8.95 ml of the nitric acid and we will make the volume up to 500 ml. Take 400 ml of distilled water in 500 ml volumetric flux. Take 8.95 ml of nitric acid by suction pipette and then slowly pour into the flask, and then mix and shake and make the volume up to 500 ml and mix again. Label the solution with its name, molarity, and then date of preparation. This will be 0.601 molar nitric acid solution. So the next experiment, how will you prepare 500 ml of 1 molar H3PO4 phosphoric acid solution when it is 85% pure? So the given things, 500 ml that is required to make for the phosphoric acid solution, and molarity is 1 molar, and the volume is 0.5 liter we need to make, purity is 85%, and molecular weight is 98, and the density is 1.685. We need to know first of all the molarity of this concentrated phosphoric acid, and then we need to make its volume that will be diluted to make the 1 molar solution of phosphoric acid. We can calculate the molarity of the concentrated phosphoric acid by using this formula, and the molarity comes out to be 14.6 molar. Then we use the M1V1 is equal to M2V2 formula to calculate the initial volume of phosphoric acid that is required to make 500 ml of the 1 molar phosphoric acid solution, and the volume of concentrated phosphoric acid comes out to be 34.2 ml. So what we will do, we will take the 400 ml of distilled water in a 500 ml volumetric flask. We will take the 34.2 ml of the phosphoric acid by suction pipette and slowly pour into the flask. Then we will mix it by shaking, then make the volume up to the 500 ml and mix again. This will be 1 molar phosphoric acid solution. Label the solution with its name, molarity and the date of preparation. The significance of nitric acid is that it is used to make the fertilizer, nylons and explosives. So the next experiment is prepare 150 ml of 2% weight by volume NaCl solution. What are the percentage solutions? Number of grams of solute present in 100 ml of a solution is called the percent solution. We need these materials to perform this experiment. What are given? The final volume we know that is required to make for NaCl is 150 ml and we need its concentration to be 2%. We need to know the mass of the NaCl to make this solution. According to the definition, 100 ml of 2% solution yields solute equal to the 2 gram, and 1 ml of 2% solution needs solute 2 divided by 100 gram, and 150 ml of 2% solution needs 2 divided by 100 multiplied by 150, and this comes out to be 3 gram. So we will weigh 3 gram of NaCl and pour it into the beaker, and then we will pour 100 ml of the distilled water into the beaker and dissolve by using a glass rod. Then we will make the volume up to 150 ml. This will be 2% NaCl solution. We will label the solution with its name, molarity and date of preparation, and we will store in an appropriate shelf. Sodium chloride is widely used in biochemistry and molecular biology research. Phosphine buffer saline is containing 137 millimole of the NaCl per liter of the solution, and PBS is used for washing cells, tissues, and is used for the injection. Next experiment, what is the weight by volume percent of 1 molar NaCl solution? We have to convert the concentration of molarity into a concentration unit of percent. We already know the percent solution are the number of grams of a solute present in 100 ml of the solution. And this is the percent solution, and the molar solution, number of moles present in 1000 ml of the solution. But I've given 1 molar we need to make, and 58.5 gram per mole NaCl, 58.5 gram per mole is the molecular weight of NaCl, and we need to know the percent of this solution. 1000 ml of 1 molar NaCl solution contains 58.5 gram, and 1 ml of 1 molar NaCl solution contains 58.5 divided by 1000, and 100 ml of 1 molar NaCl solution contains 58.5 divided by 1000 multiplied by 100, and this comes out to be 5.85 gram. Because this quantity of NaCl is present in 100 ml, that is the definition of percent solution. So therefore, the volume by weight percent of 1 molar NaCl solution is 5.85%. So NaCl is routinely used for the DNA extraction buffer. The human body contains sodium chloride as a major salt. So the next experiment is prepare 200 ml of 200 ppm calcium chloride solution. Ppm is defined as the number of milligrams of the solute dissolved in 1000 ml of the solution. We need these materials to perform this experiment. So what we need to find, and we already know, is 200 ml of solution is required to make, and its concentration must be 200 ppm. And we need to know the mass of the solute. According to the definition, 1 liter of 1 ppm solution contains 1 milligram, and 1 liter of 200 ppm solution contains 200 milligram, and 1000 ml of 200 ppm solution contains 200 milligram. These are the same thing actually, both the things are same. And 1 ml of 200 ppm solution contains 200 divided by 1000, and 200 ml of 200 ppm solution contains 200 divided by 1000 multiplied by 200, and that comes out to be 40 milligram. So 40 milligram is required to dilute to make a volume of 200 ml, and that will be equal to 200 ppm then. So what are the steps? Take 150 ml of distilled water in a beaker, then add 40 milligram of calcium chloride in a beaker and dissolve using a glass rod. Make the volume up to 200 ml using the volumetric flask and mix again. Label the solution with its name, molarity and the date of preparation. This will be 200 ml of 200 ppm calcium chloride solution. PPM is a parts per million that is used to describe very small concentration. Like some of the air pollutants are found in very small concentration, and the concentration unit of PPM is utilized to define their concentrations. Prepare 100 ml of 20 ppb calcium chloride solution from its stock of. So parts per billion is defined as the number of micrograms of a solute dissolved in 1000 ml of the solution. What are given? The initial concentration of the calcium chloride stock solution is 100 ppm, and we need to make 20 ppb by its dilution, and the final volume that we need to make is 100 ml. We need to know the initial volume of the concentrated calcium chloride that will be utilized to make the 20 ppb solution. So we will use the C1, V1 and C2, V2 formula, and we are going to calculate by using the same units. We will convert the ppm into the ppb, and the stock solution has a 100 multiplied by 1000 parts per billion concentration multiplied by Vx, initial volume that is required to know, and the 20 parts per billion solution final concentration, and the final volume must be the 100 ml. And the Vx, the V1, so Vx, the volume comes out to be 0.02 ml, that is equal to the 20 microliter. So we will take the 20 microliter of the stock solution, and we will dilute to make 100 ml, and the final concentration of this solution then will be 20 parts per billion. So the procedure is that 100 ml of the distilled water is taken in a cylinder and add 20 microliter of the 100 ppm calcium chloride solution. This will be 100 ml of 20 ppb calcium chloride. So how to make the parallel and the serial dilutions of the copper sulfate? For the serial dilution, we know its definition are dilution series of a stock of solution where concentration decreases by the same quantity in each successive step. And in the parallel dilution, it is the technique of making a single diluted solution. It is the technique of making a single diluted solution of a specific concentration. So this is the example of the serial dilution, and this is the example of parallel dilution. In serial dilution, we are going to add the same volume into the tube 1, and the same volume is taken from the tube 1 and is added to the tube 2, and the same volume of the same volume is taken from tube 2 to tube 3 and so on. So this kind of dilution series is called the serial dilution, and this kind of dilution is utilized in making the standard curve, and that is more authentic in making the standard curve, the parallel dilutions. We add a specific volume in a tube 1 and in the tube 2 and tube 3 and tube 4. This way we make the parallel dilutions. So we are going to perform this experiment. I will be teaching you. The distilled water is taken 9 ml in each tube. This is for the serial dilutions. And then we will take the stock solution of 10 ml, and then is added 1 ml to the tube 1, 1 ml of which, okay, then 1 ml of the stock solution is added to tube 1, and after the dissolution 1 ml is taken and is added to tube 2, and after dissolution 1 ml is added to next tube, after dissolution 1 ml is added to tube 3. And this way we are going to dilute the stock solution by 10 times in the first tube, and in the 100 times in the second tube, and in the 1000 time in third, and 10,000 time in the fourth. In the same way, if the stock solution is 1 molar, we will multiply the dilution ratio with the stock concentration. If we multiply 1 by 1 by 10, it comes out to be 0.1 molar. In the same way, 1 when it is multiplied by this dilution ratio, the answer comes out to be 0.01. Actually, the same concentration will be there, the molar, and 0.001 molar concentration will be there in the tube 3, and 0.0001 molar concentration will be there in the tube 4. But in the case of parallel dilutions, we are going to use 1 molar stock solution. Distilled water is taken 0 ml, 9 ml, 7 ml, 5 ml, and 3 ml in 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th tube. This is the stock. When 1 ml is added to tube 5, and from the original stock is again utilized to add 3 ml to tube 6, and then 5 ml to tube 7, and 7 ml to tube 8. In this way, we add different quantities of the stock solution in different tubes, and we diluted the stock solution in the first tube by 1 by 10 times, and the second tube 3 by 10 times, and in the fifth tube 5 by 10 times, and in the eighth tube 7 by 10. 7 by 10 means 7 ml was utilized and total volume was made 10 ml. After the addition of 7 ml stock, total volume is 10, so it is 7 by 10 times diluted parallel dilution in the tube number 8. So we multiply the dilution ratio with the stock concentration, and the stock concentration is 1 molar. Stock concentration is 1 molar. When multiplied by 1 by 10, it comes out to be 0.1 molar. 3.10 dilution ratio multiplied by 1 comes out to be 0.3 and 0.5 and 0.7. So serial dilutions are utilized to find IC50 values of the drugs. Parallel dilution can be utilized to make standards for the calibration curve for the standard curves. The dilution series can be used for the spiking also. So next is the compare calculated and measured values of a solution that is 10 to the power minus 7 moles of HCl dissolved per ml of the solution. What's the principle? Any number of moles of HCl added to the water will decrease its pH. We need these materials to perform this experiment. Pure water has a pH of 7. It has H positive ion concentration 10 to the power minus 7 molar. The added H positive ion will increase the concentration of H positive ions. We can see 1 ml of H positive ion concentration is equal to the 10 to the power minus 7 moles. And 1000 ml of H positive ion concentration will be 10 to the power minus 7 multiplied by 1000, and it comes out to be 10 to the power minus 4 moles per liter. Thus H positive ion concentration, the final concentration of H positive ions will be 10 to the power minus 4 moles per liter. And if we take the pH, the minus logarithm of this H positive ion concentration, it comes out to be 4. So the final pH of the solution will be 4 molar. Turn on the pH meter and wash its electrode with distilled water, and then calibrate the pH meter by using a standard buffer. Then dip the electrode into the solution of unknown pH. Note the pH when reading is not fluctuating, and then calculate the value of the pH using Anderson-Heiselberg equation. Calculate both the values that should differ by a small fraction of the pH. So the next experiment is 10 grams of the K2PO4 and 10 grams of the KH2PO4 were dissolved in 500 ml. Show difference between the calculated and the measured pH. So these values are given. The molecular weight of each of the KH2PO4 and K2HPO4 are given. We already know the definition of buffer. A buffer resists a change in a pH by proton donating and proton accepting abilities. We need to make the volume 0.5 liter, 500 ml, and the mass of K2HPO4 and KH2PO4 are 10 gram each. This is the procedure. We will see procedure after making the calculation. So the moles of K2HPO4 are 0.115 molar, and moles of KH2PO4 comes out to be 0.147 moles per liter. And we know this is Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, and pH can be calculated by putting the values of salt concentration, and salt here is this one, K2HPO4, and by putting the concentration of an acid, that is KH2PO4, and the pH comes out to be 6.75. Next experiment is prepare 1 liter of 0.2 molar phosphate buffer of 7.2 pH. This is a very interesting experiment, and the pKa of H2PO4 is 8, and the pKa of H2PO4 is 6.86. We know this is Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, and this is the ionization pattern, and we put the values of pH, pKa in the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, and the equation comes out to be in this form. And we know we can take a 6.86 to the other side of the equation, and it will be deducted from the 7.2, and the value will come out to be 0.34. And 0.34, if we take the anti-log, the value will appear as 2.19, that becomes equal to the concentration of the salt divided by the concentration of the acid. So from this equation, we can know that sum of the ratio of the salt and the acid is equal to the 1, and 2.19, that becomes equal to 3.19. And the molarity of the salt in the buffer solution should be the share of that component divided by the total shares multiplied by the final molarity of the buffer system, that comes out to be 0.137 molar. In a buffer of 0.2 molar, the concentration of K2HPO4 must be 0.137 molar, and in the same way, the molarity of the KH2PO4 should be 0.063 molar when we have to make the 0.2 molar phosphate buffer. And from these molarities, these two molarities, we can calculate the weight that is required for each of the K2HPO4 and KH2PO4, and the weight of the dipotassium hydrogen phosphates comes out to be 18.68, and for the potassium dihydrogen phosphate it is 10.97 gram per liter. So this way we can take these quantities and we dissolve. This is going to give us 0.2 molar. This is going to give us 0.2 molar phosphate buffer of 1 liter volume. So the next experiment is to prepare 100 ml of lysis buffer for the protein extraction. So we are going to use this recipe that will be given. This 50 millimolar is required as a final concentration, and 150 millimolar NaCl, and 0.5% triton X100, and 1 millimolar EDTA. So the triton X100 acts as a surfactant, and this maintains the pH of the buffer. NaCl provides a suitable ionic concentration for the solubility of the protein. EDTA is utilized to reduce the protease activity. So these are the materials required for this experiment. In order to make this multi-component buffer, we will have a stock of 2 molar trace, 5 molar NaCl, and 10% triton X100, and 0.5 molar EDTA, and we have to find their volume that will be diluted to attain a final concentration of 50 millimolar for trace, 150 millimolar for NaCl, and 0.5% for triton X100, and 1 millimolar for EDTA. We use the M1V1 formula to find the initial volume. We have to make same units for each concentration, like 2000 millimolar of trace. How much of its volume is required to get the 50 millimolar final concentration with a final volume of 100 ml, and the Vx initial volume comes out to be 2.5 ml. In the same way, 5000 millimolar of MgCl, how much of its volume is required to attain a final concentration of 150 millimolar with a final volume of 100 ml, and the volume comes out to be 3 ml. And for the Teton 800, it comes out to be 5 ml, and for the EDG, it comes out to be 0.2 ml. So we have to take 2.5 ml of 2 molar trace and 3 ml of 5 molar NaCl and 5 ml of the 10% Teton 800 and 0.2 ml of the EDTA, and we will make the final volume up to 100 ml, and this will be our desired solution. So this is the procedure you can read here. So all the protocols have been majorly taken from the Sembrook, the molecular cloning laboratory manual. And thanks for watching. This is the end of chapter 2, solutions, buffers, pH and dilution series.